And welcome to anybody joining with us online by the live stream. Well, as we begin our worship this morning, let us turn our focus to Psalm 100, verses 1 and 2. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. And let us do just that. So I invite you to stand as we sing, That's What We Came Here For.
Presence with singing, come into your presence with praise, enter your gates with thankful hearts. We are going to celebrate, all of heaven's waiting, now is on its way. So we shout hallelujah, lift into your mighty roar of praise. You deserve the highest praise that we can.
Children of God, and he died because of his love for us.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in, oh, his love for me. Oh, his love.
Bye.
As we move into a time of prayer, let the words of this next song resonate within our hearts. For you, Lord, are holy.
Thank you.
Dear Lord, you are holy. You lived and died for us so that we may be saved. Lord, we pray this morning that your Holy Spirit will burn brightly within us in our church, that we may be transformed by your Spirit during this time of worship together. We pray this in your heavenly name. Amen.
The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom should I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Whom should I dread? I have asked one thing from the Lord. It is what I desire, to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, gazing on the beauty of the Lord and seeking him in his temple. For he will conceal me in his shelter in the day of adversity. He will hide me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Then my head will be high above my enemies around me, and I will offer sacrifices in his tent with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. I am certain that I will see the Lord's goodness in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart be courageous. Wait for the Lord.
And we're going to do that just now. Wait on the Lord as we spend some time in prayer. We'll be thinking about obedience today. And there's some scripture and a prayer that I'll share as we lead into this time. But there can be freedom about whatever is on our hearts to pray for today. We've got an election coming up, don't we? That's one thing to be praying for. We read of a family devastated on their way to a concert. And I'm sure there's many needs amongst us here. So let's wait on the Lord today, and there'll be a time of open prayer. So if anyone would like to lead us in prayer, two or three, whatever, as the Spirit leads. But let's turn our attention to the Lord and waiting on him. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Father God, I must admit that I struggle to obey you immediately. I know that delayed obedience is still disobedience. Just as you command children to obey their parents, you command your children to obey you. I long to work out my salvation with fear and trembling in you, because the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. I want to make wise decisions that honor and please you above all. I need your grace and Spirit to empower me to obey. So I rest in you and trust you are working in my regenerated heart. Please give me a hunger for your word, so that my mind can be renewed to be able to say no to the world and the flesh, and yes to you. Thank you for finishing the work you have begun in me. Let there be that freedom in prayer, if anyone would like to intercede for us to the throne of God. Who will lead? Lord, I just pray for all levels of government, local, state, and federal, Lord, that you would be speaking your will into their lives, that they would know what you would want for this country. We pray in particular for the state election coming up, Lord. It's always difficult to make decisions who we should vote for, but Lord, I just pray that we'd spend time with you, that we would seek your will for this state and who the right people are to be governing. Lord, we pray for those who are putting their hands up to become members of parliament. Lord, we just pray a blessing on them. This will be a busy, intense time for them. Trying to get their points across, I just pray for a positive atmosphere. The people will bring ideas of what they can bring to this state so that we may come up with the government that you wish for, Lord, that you have planned and designed for us. Praise in your name.
Well, Heavenly Father, how easy it is to pray that you would bless the plans that we have. Well, at this important time, Lord, I would ask that we take that whole thought from our mind and that you would bring about your plans and show us our place in your plan, that we would be working with you, not asking you to work for us. And that's the same in our government. Lord, we would ask that you would bring people who are willing to work for us, but that hear from you in the decisions they should make. For this state, Lord, we would ask a revival in faith. As much as we crave people for the Salvation Army, Lord, we crave more people for your kingdom. We crave them whether they go to any other church. We just want them to find your kingdom in their heart, their eternal place. And so, Father, we would ask that you would guide our prayers in these days, that we would not be selfish in prayer, but we would pray your will at all times, that your will be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Because with that, Lord, would be the coming of Christ to earth. And we crave that day, Lord. So, Father, give us clear thinking. Give us a listening ear when we pray. Let us pause to hear you, that we would be in your will in these days.
Thank you for your Son, who hears us through the Spirit, and intercedes for us to the throne of the Father. Hallelujah.
announcements. What's going on? I don't know most of the time, so I'll try and keep this all on the straight and narrow as best I can. Next Sunday we'll have a visit by Compassion, from Johanna, who's come and visited around this time of year. This will be at least the third visit, if not the fourth. Come along and just hear what Compassion are up to. Very involved in youth and children's work around this world through the child sponsorship programs that they have, but not only that, their programs associated with that in communities right around the world. And I know there are a number here who sponsor children through Compassion. So our open plate offering next week will also be given in support of Compassion if you want to also contribute to that. Only 5 weeks away, so I believe, and now it coincides with a state election day. We didn't know that when we started to plan it, but anyway. Visit of the Melbourne Staff Songsters, March 23rd, which as we all know is a Saturday now, and Sunday the 24th. So there'll be a Saturday evening concert, Clabberet, commencing at 7 p.m. There will be a ticket price on that, not too dear, but more details to follow. And of course the Songsters will be leading Sunday morning worship. There'll be an afternoon of praise and song at 1:30 p.m. There's some vocal workshops on the Saturday afternoon, so details still being worked through. But certainly if you're able to put in 7 p.m. on the Saturday night and Sunday the 24th with the Melbourne Staff Songsters leading us on. And of course, their leader is very well known to us, Jeffrey, who was here for many, many years prior to his move to Melbourne with Christine about 4 years ago. I think they moved now, so it'd be great to see them back with the group. And an announcement for Kids Church. There will be no Kids Church next week, the 25th of February. Could because the children will be participating in the Soggy Bottom Cardboard Box Boat Regatta at the Cataract Gorge Pool. They've been busy making their boats. I'm going to continue doing that today. And they'll be able to mark this off as supporting a local community project as they work towards completing their Junior Soldier Awards. The event is raising funds to support Diabetes Tasmania and JCP Youth. So if you'd like to support the team by making a donation, please see Angela after the meeting. I've got all the paperwork and all the safeguarding in place as well, so it's all good to go. So it'll be a great event. I know they've been very excited making their boats last week and again this week. So we'll cheer them on and hopefully they'll take out the prize. Yeah, got to be competitive as well. We continue with the giving of in worship with our tithes and offerings. Thank you, Jan.
Generous Father, All things are created through you and for you. As we bring our tithes and offerings, please accept them as a response to your goodness. Open the windows of heaven and send down blessings upon blessings. May your peace reign in our lives, your love surround us, and your joy upholds us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you to the songsters. Well, last week we commenced our self-denial appeal for this year, 2024. The self-denial appeal, of course, being an appeal that's made right around the Salvation Army world in all of the, I'm going to say 133 countries in which we now operate. Well, it's 131 to 133, something like that. I can't remember the exact number. Of course, to support, the work of the Salvation Army right around our world. As we said last week, of course, in a more affluent country like Australia, even with the struggles that we're facing, we know that most of the giving will go overseas to support many projects and many work for the kingdom in a number of places. So I think there was letters from our territorial commander, Commissioner Miriam Lewis, that went out last week. If you haven't got one of those and would like one, Ian can help you with that. And the altar service is on the 17th of March. So in a couple of weeks prior, we'll be handing out the giving envelopes for those that would like them and are able to participate in that way. So we'll speak more a little bit about it in the weeks ahead, but I will watch the project. I think we're off to the Philippines this week,
and a young man with his chickens.
Jesus, let your love shine through us, or let it lead to action.
I love learning about science and how the world works. My name is Donato, and I'm in year 11 at school. I work hard at my studies, and I am a consistent honor student. When I graduate, I dream of becoming a marine engineer.
Wala aras babaw.
Coming from a big family, my parents struggled to pay my school fees. So thankfully, I was a beneficiary of the child sponsorship program at the Corps. We were very grateful for the sponsorship. However, our family was facing an uncertain future as the support would end when I graduated from school. 2 years ago, my family was very happy when we were invited to transition into the SICA project. The new project supports families to build sustainable livelihoods and plan a better future. When we joined the program, we were given 5 chickens. We also completed a training session on how to take care for them and build a business. Now, we have over 50 chickens and make a good profit selling the chickens and the eggs. Every morning, I come with my family to feed the chickens before school. I collect rice hulls on a tricycle for the bedding to keep the birds clean and dry. The whole family loves caring for them. They are great animals to keep. Our organic chickens and eggs are in high demand, and my parents are happy to have a reliable food source and income. We are very thankful for the SICA program, and our work will benefit us all into the future. The funds support me and my siblings through school, and my parents are now able to build a more permanent house. The Corps has always been a big part of my life, and I like to serve in the worship band. My grandmother was one of the founding members over 3 decades ago. Now, 4 generations of my family attend and bring our tithes and self-denial offerings to the Corps. I am very thankful for the Salvation Army and excited for my future.
The SICA program in the Philippines helps families transition from child sponsorship to a community sustainable program. Through this, we will able to help the families to upgrade the level of life. And we are now coming to you to appeal to help the self-denial in order to help these families and individual children, not only here in the Philippines, but in the entire world. And thank you. Please give generously.
We're going to sing again. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I invite you to stand.
Oh, your mercy now. I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness. Darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God.
Well, who likes being told what to do? Yeah, well, for the laughter, not some of us. I'd imagine very few of us, actually, when we get down to it. And though the origins most likely lie in earlier years, it seems to be something that particularly develops around teenager time, when any wise word of instruction or important life lessons to obey is met with a grunt of indignation, if there's any acknowledgement at all. Especially in family, there's particular traits or expectations around thoughts and obedience to certain things. And that's to say, what each family considers the higher priorities for what to obey may differ. Some may place respect of others as one of the top obedience markers. Others, hard work. Others, on not letting the dogs inside every time we're about to sit down for dinner. Don't trip over them, we've got small dogs, remember? Anyway. Usually the things where obedience is requested are important, or there's a good reason, or a life value behind it. Yes, children are told to honour their parents, but Scripture also says parents do not exasperate your children. So it's not just obedience for obedience's sake, but we trust given for good intentions, such as to be respectful, to be safe, to be diligent, to be reliable, to be accountable, to have integrity, and so on. Now, there's a lot of people out there not actively involved in the church, not yet a disciple of Jesus Christ, who think that what the church is all about is telling people what to do, giving them rules to follow and keep. I'm sure you've come across those attitudes in your lifetime, have you not? Yeah? Maybe sometimes it has even felt like that for us. It's about rule keeping. It's an impingement upon our freedom. After all, the scripture says, no discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Some good stuff in the scripture, isn't it? When we accept the gift of God's salvation, become a disciple of Jesus Christ, we become part of the family of God. We become sons and daughters of God. So thus we become part of a new family of obedience, so to speak, at that point. And to go deeper in our discipleship of Jesus Christ, by following him, by being transformed into his likeness, a copy of God, as Ian shared last week, we need to grasp what being part of the same family of obedience as our Master, Jesus, means. Now, obedience has almost become one of those frowned upon words in Western society these days. For individual freedom is seen as a paramount virtue. You know, in a climate that's passionate about freedom and autonomy, the virtue of obedience can be misunderstood or it can even be brushed off. For these days, obedience can be seen as an obstacle to expressing our freedom. Now, Jesus is the perfect model of Christian obedience, yet we would also say that he was completely free. But Jesus also said, if the Son sets you free, you'll be free indeed. We've already sung about freedom in Christ today, how God pulls these links together. Well, let's look at that model of Christian obedience, of the family of obedience of Jesus, the obedience between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, undivided in essence, co-equal in power and glory, as the scriptures say and our doctrines reflect, but there was still strong obedience within the autonomy and the freedom of the perfect holy relationship of the Trinity. We'll start in the Gospel of John, chapter 4, just after Jesus had encountered the Samaritan woman at the well. The disciples return and they tell Jesus to eat after a long day of walking in the heat. And Jesus responds by saying, I have food to eat of which you do not know. And the disciples, still focused on worldly practical matters as they were, they think Jesus must have stashed something they didn't know about. Or more likely they say, someone else must have bought him something while we were gone. But aware of their cluelessness, Jesus was pretty good on the cluelessness of the disciples, he continues, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to accomplish his work. Now for Jesus, the will of God the Father and accomplishing that was his food and his strength. The will of God the Father wasn't a limitation to Jesus' freedom. He didn't see it that way. Instead, Jesus' will and the will of God the Father were one and the same thing. Jesus reiterates this truth to his disciples and any listening across his time with them. That was his whole job of being with them that time and teaching them the word of his truth. John 6:38, for I've come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. John 8:28, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, when he is crucified, then you will know that I am he and that I do nothing on my own, but speak just what the Father taught me. And then, of course, in the Garden of Gethsemane, on the night before the cross, where Jesus agonized and he prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. Jesus came to obey the will of Heavenly Father, full stop. That meant certain things, most significantly, enduring death by crucifixion, so that we could be saved, forgiven, and reconciled back to God. If we claim to be followers of Jesus, if we claim to be his disciples, then deep or mature discipleship understands that we are to be transformed into the same family of obedience, that our desire becomes to do the will of our Heavenly Father. And Jesus extended the invitation to his followers in this, reading from Matthew 12, 46 to 50. While Jesus was still talking to the crowd, his mother and brothers stood outside, wanting to speak to him. Someone told him, "Your mother and brothers are standing outside, wanting to speak to you." He replied to them, "Who is my mother, and who are my brothers?" Pointing to his disciples, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." Or as Luke 8:21 puts it, "My mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it." If you want to go deeper in your following of Jesus Christ, I think this is one of the scriptures to always keep in mind. Jesus said we are part of his family when we understand that as his followers, we now belong to the same family of obedience as what he lived and showed and modeled to us. A family of obedience to do the will of our Heavenly Father. So what does that mean? Well, that could be a very long discussion. I'll try to condense it down to a few points today. We'll see how we go. The virtue of obedience, so belonging to the same family of obedience as Jesus, is more than just blindly following instructions. It's more than rule keeping. It's more than mere conformance to God's ways, begrudgingly or otherwise. Rather, it is to seek God and to understand the propositions or the things he sets before us to expand and enrich our sense of his kingdom. It's an obedience that is grown and deepened by taking the time to pray and to discern in silence. Or I'd certainly say, if not silence, to discern in stillness, that still waiting before the Lord. So we can be enlightened by the Holy Spirit. Now, one of the first things our spiritual enemy will do in trying to pull us away from the family of obedience of God is to steal our time, to distract us, to keep us busy. So we struggle to find that quiet, seeking and discerning time with God. The more we become distracted, the more we are kept busy, the easier it is for our enemy to deceive us away from the truth of God's obedience. In finding the time for that seeking, discerning, we ask the Holy Spirit to help us see the truth of God's will rather than just being constrained by our own limited point of view. And belonging to the same family of obedience as Jesus, it goes beyond compromise. You know, I'll keep obedience to all these commands, God, if, you know, I can just have a little bit of leeway here. We can't pick and choose from the gospel message what we choose to obey. But as a follower of Jesus Christ, we go with the same gospel message that he proclaimed, all the fullness of it. Ian spoke about that last week also. Obeying God is allowing his grace to freely flow through our lives so that we have a will which becomes fully identified with his. And it is a work of grace. A work of grace so that God's desires become our desires. We want things just as much as God wants it. The salvation of family members yet to know the Lord, for example. Because the scripture says, you know, God is wanting all to come to him. He is patient in not bringing his judgment upon the earth because he doesn't want anyone to be lost. Now, because we still carry our sinful nature, it's inherent within us until we are fully glorified for all eternity, such obedience isn't always necessary. You see, we don't like being told what to do we? It doesn't always come naturally to us. So obedience to the will of our Heavenly Father is a grace we need to ask for and seek daily. Now, discipleship that holds obedience merely at the level of conformity or compromise, it's not only superficial, could actually say it's not true discipleship at all. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus gave this warning, Matthew 7, 21 to 23. "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles?' Then I'll tell them plainly, 'I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. You are not part of my family. I don't recognize you as my family.'" You know, obedience and discerning the will of our Heavenly Father, it's not a transactional process. It's not do this and you'll be right. It's a much deeper matter of heart and intent. So it's when our understanding of obedience as a follower of Jesus moves beyond simply conforming or attempts to compromise that we actually start to experience a joyous and supernatural obedience is indeed possible. We can live it. Amen. In our own strength, we commonly lack the faith to believe that God's plan or will is far better than our own. But God is sovereign over all. You know, he sees our lives through an infinitely wider perspective, you know, part of his redemptive plan. Whereas we often only see pieces at a time or what's the challenge immediately in front of us. Again, we need to ask for the grace of faith and patience to be growing in obedience and also to trust. Is that not what that old chorus reveals to us? Obedience will grow through our trust in God. I'm in his hands. I'm in his hands. Whatever the future holds, I'm in his hands. The days I cannot see have all been planned for me. His way is best. You see, I'm in his hands. Belonging to the same family of obedience as Jesus brings a recognition that Christ's obedience gives us a status beyond simply being forgiven. Redemptive work of Jesus on the cross means we are free from eternal punishment. We are free from the wages of sin, which is death. Hallelujah. But often followers of Christ, I think, still labour under a sense of guilt, for we know we are not yet still the kind of people we should be and how often we still fail. But strangely enough, it is knowing that we belong to the same family of obedience as Jesus that removes any sense of guilt, even when we do fail. Certainly we need to seek forgiveness when we do fail. We need to continue to repent. We need to be ever turning towards God, continue to seek the ongoing work of grace of God in our life and transforming us to be more and more like Christ. But in God's family of obedience, there is no longer any condemnation. We are not simply pardoned criminals, but we've been clothed with righteousness. Hebrews 12:11, which I referenced earlier, only gave the first part of it. For it actually says, for the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Isn't that wonderful? The peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. We are now beloved sons and daughters with whom God is well pleased because we are united to Christ, the head of our spiritual family. And our obedience remains with Jesus, now seated at God's right hand, completely unassailable, provided we remain in him. As our ninth doctrine says, we've already read it once today, we believe that continuance in a state of salvation, so continuance in the family of God, depends upon continued obedient faith in Christ. And following Jesus as part of his family of obedience means our fundamental identity of who and all we are is now found in nothing else than Jesus, our Lord. You know, our world is an achievement-driven world. Now, there's not necessarily anything wrong with that. Yet our achievements in the workplace, in education, in wealth building, in our common bonds of ethnicity or gender, so achieving together, our political activism to seek a better world, the approval of peers, of family, etc. All of these good gifts are easily marred by sin, and our achievements can lead to deep hurt and frustration for us or others. But when we anchor our souls in the reality of God's acceptance of us because of Christ's sinless obedience, we have great freedom to enter every sphere of life without overloading any other identity marker with a weight that it wasn't meant to bear. That's a long sentence, but I'm going to read it again because it bears thinking about. When we anchor ourselves in the reality of God's acceptance of us because of Christ's sinless obedience, we have great freedom to enter every sphere of life without overloading any other of our identity markers with a weight that it wasn't meant to bear. You know, that's the paradox. That's the paradox of obedience versus freedom the world doesn't understand. It is through full obedience to God, full obedience to His perfect will, that we are completely free. For then, we enter into life free from any weight of sin, delivered from the weight of sin. We are delivered from sin at salvation. But as we continue to seek God daily with that ongoing grace that was spoken about, we continue to enter into every aspect of life free from the weight of sin, delivered from sin. That's when discipleship can go deep and following Jesus becomes powerful, for it is the power of Jesus, of the Holy Spirit, in which we go. Obedience is the hallmark of our submission. As followers of Jesus, we must commit ourselves to obey Him in all aspects of our lives. It's central to the great commission Jesus gave to His followers to go and make disciples, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. As we've said, obedience is not optional for the follower of Jesus Christ. We don't pick which commands to obey and which ones to not. There's another old chorus, I'm on my old choruses today, that says, by the pathway of duty flows the river of God's grace. Now, our duty is not what we do, not in the outwork of our service to God and serving God. Rather, it stems from this. Our duty in deeper discipleship is our love for God. It's our devotion to Him, our devotion to our Father's will. John 14:15, if you love me, obey my commandments. Can't get much simpler than that, can it? Jesus said, if you love me, obey my commandments. Through His suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension, Jesus has done everything to put us in a spiritual position to obey God. For Jesus bore our sins in His body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. 1 Peter 2:24. So a true or a deep follower of Christ, one who is being transformed into His likeness, knows we belong to the same family of obedience as Christ. So we should seek to obey Jesus at all times and in everything. Jesus recognized members of His family as those who hear the word of God, who consider it, who understand it, who attend to it, and then follow by doing what it says. Obedience cannot be overemphasized, for obedience brings God glory. God gave His followers grace and authority to preach the gospel so that people will believe and obey Him and bring glory to His name. Romans 1:5. So just to reiterate, a deep disciple of Jesus understands they belong to the same family of obedience as what He showed us. And thus the one thing we can do to bring glory to God is to live our lives according to His word, to His will. As we obey God, as we go to do the will of our Heavenly Father, unbelievers will witness our good works and give glory to God. Amen. Thank you, worship. Talks about resting on God, about waiting on Him. Our places of prayer are open today. The way of God in prayer is always open. He is waiting for you to seek Him. He is waiting for you to discern His will for your life. A will that will align you to our Heavenly Father as was spoken about. We want to be faithful followers of His. We want to be within the will of God, do we not? So in these moments of freedom, let us turn our attention to Him once again. Let us seek Him however we need to, and hear from Him, we pray.
Here I am longing for you.
Heavenly Father, may we indeed be fully surrendered and yielded to your will. And Lord, may we seek daily the grace we need to do that. We know how inclined we are to want to go our own way still, to race ahead, to get the job done without first considering your ways and your perfect plan. So Lord, we keep your spirit ever close to us as you promised to do. And may we be aware of your presence at all times, we pray. So that we are having that constant conversation with you, directing us and guiding us, whispering your peace and confident assurance to us. We want to be faithful servants, faithful followers of you, so that the world will see and glorify your name. So Lord, empower us and embolden us. When perhaps those whispers come that we think, oh, I could never do that, that just sounds crazy, that we correctly discern it is from you. And we know that if it is from you, you will equip us with everything we need. You will provide all that is needed for us to follow. Help us continue to be ever found in your word, to be ever understanding exactly what you asked your followers to do, that you commanded them to do, so that we may be ever falling deeper in love with Jesus, we pray. Thank you.
Well, I invite you to stand as we sing our final song, God of this city.
To the rest of
Join us for morning tea.